By the end of that 100 years, technical development had transformed the classic single-purpose machines. There were even improved calculating machines, but these were not computers. They too were single-purpose machines performing individual operations, an addition or a multiplication. Computing, the step-by-step following of a mathematical sequence, still relied on a human being. The computer was still a person. Babbage's idea that she could be replaced by a machine had made no progress at all. The first real move towards changing the meaning of the word computer took place here in Berlin in the early 30s. Responsible was a young engineering student, Konrad Zuse. He had a limited objective at first. It was simply to avoid hard work.
Ja, das ist ja wohl klar, dass ein junger Mensch, der gerne andere Dinge treibt, nicht nur studiert und rechnet, und auch als Ingenieur hat man ja diese andere Ideen im Kopf, als nur zu rechnen. Man hat Pläne bezüglich von dem Brückenbau und so weiter. Und dass dieses durch die Rechnerei nun dazu erforderlich ist, die umfangreiche Rechnerei, das ist natürlich zunächst durchaus nicht angenehm. Und das kann man sagen, ich war zu faul zum Rechnen und da fand den Computer.
As he thought about building a computer, Zuse realized he needed a completely new approach to engineering design. Most machines, including the aeroplanes that Zuse was working on at the time, are built of a few basic subsystems, like the power plant, the hydraulic system, wing assemblies, and so on. Each system has a structure completely different from all the others, and once they're assembled, the purpose of the machine is determined. No amount of juggling of systems would turn these planes into cars. But a computing machine would need to be adaptable, like the human it sought to replace. The human computer used simple components, just 10 numbers and a few signs. By moving them about and arranging them in different ways, she could perform any of a huge range of tasks in arithmetic, from stress analysis to calculating the positions of stars. If Zuse's machine was to be able to vary its role to the same degree, ideally it should be made of lots of identical components whose function in the whole could be changed as necessary.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
The element Zuse chose as ideal for his machine was a component widely used in the telephone industry. The electric relay, a simple on-off switch, was operated by passing a current through a coil. The current magnetized the coil and closed the switch. A relay had just two positions, open and closed. And this led Zuse to make a second important decision. His computer should count in the binary scale.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Probably because we have 10 fingers, almost all human societies count in tens. It's so ingrained, it seems to be the only natural way to count. But there are other ways which are just as effective. The binary system uses only two different digits, 0 and 1. But these two digits can be used for counting just as efficiently as the 10. The advantage of having only two digits is that they can be represented very simply, by whether a switch is on or off. Taking on as 1 and off as 0, then an electric circuit can do binary arithmetic. An input of 1 plus 1 adds up to the binary equivalent of 2, 1 followed by 0. But it takes several relays to do this, the most basic of sums. To do significant arithmetic, Zuse's computer would need hundreds of switches. His machine filled the family's front room. He tried a number of different types of switch, but found that his first idea, electric relays, were the most effective. Using his parents and university friends as labour, Zuse solved most of the basic design problems. By 1939, he was the world's leading computer designer. The outbreak of the Second World War was the decisive event that would change the computer from a small private initiative to a large government-funded enterprise. Zuse was conscripted into the army and served for 6 months before he was demobbed, when it was realized that he could do more for the war effort as an engineer rather than as a soldier. With the help of military funding, though still working at home in his spare time, Zuse built a series of machines using telephone relays. And to program them, he ingeniously got over wartime shortages by punching his program into rolls of discarded movie film. By the end of 1941, Zuse had succeeded in building the machine which Babbage had dreamed of 100 years before. He had a programmable general-purpose computer, and time would prove that his basic structure and the use of binary arithmetic were right. But Zuse was dissatisfied with his machine's speed. It took up to 5 seconds to perform a multiplication. And by now there was a faster switch available. The valve, or vacuum tube, was the foundation of the new electronics industry. Valves were most commonly used in the manufacture of radios, where they acted as amplifiers, but they could be used equally well as lightning-fast switches.
In an electromagnetic relay, the switching is done physically by a piece of metal that must move from one set of contacts to another. In a vacuum tube, the switching is done by electrons, which, for all our purposes, can be considered to have no mass at all, no inertia. You can switch them very rapidly simply by turning on or off another current. That in practice means that you get switching speeds around 1,000 to 2,000 times faster than the best relays.
One of the friends who helped Zuse build his first machine, Helmut Schreier, suggested that he should use these electronic components.
Und da kam man in meine Werkstatt und sagte, musst du mit Röhren machen. Und zunächst dachte ich, es wäre sein neues Studentenulk. Aber wir überlegten uns das und der Gedanke, dass man also einmal 1,000 Mal schneller rechnen können würde, das war damals also märchenhaft.
Excited by the prospect of such a fantastically fast machine, the two young men laid their plans. They calculated that working together, it would take them 2 years. But when in 1941 they put in a request for funding, the German High Command turned them down. Hitler had decided that no long-term projects should be undertaken. The war, he said, would be won in much less than 2 years.
Es war damals schon klar, dass eine Bayern entweder, dass er mit 2 Jahren entwickelt, das war einfach zu lang. Und auf die Weise ist aus der elektronischen Entwicklung in Deutschland auch nichts geworden.
The valve would transform the computer, not for Zuse, but across the Atlantic.
The United States' entry into the war had brought with it a crisis that could well threaten Allied lives. The supply of the latest weapons to the Allied forces was threatened by, of all things, a shortage of mathematicians. To aim any gun that fired over the visible horizon, gunners needed firing tables. These told them what angle they should set the barrel at to reach a given target, depending on different conditions. The tables were calculated on the basis of data produced by test firings. At the U.S. Army Proving Ground at Aberdeen, Maryland, women had taken over to free men for the fighting front, and this part of the task was not the problem. The problem lay in the mass of computation needed to turn test data into a firing table. Calculating one path of a shell took 750 multiplications, involving wind force and direction, air temperature and density, as well as different shells and fuses. There was so much work that the Army set up a special computing group at the University of Pennsylvania. Among the computers there was Kay McNulty.
To do just one trajectory at one particular angle usually took somewhere between 30 and 40 hours of calculation on this desk calculator. And these trajectories, after they were done, were going to be incorporated in a firing table, and one needed about 1,800 of these trajectories to prepare one firing table. So there was a tremendous job load there.
Captain Herman Goldstein was responsible for getting through that job load. It seemed impossible, with a new table needed for every new gun, and one table taking up to 4 woman years.
We were getting farther behind all the time, so it became clear to me that we had to do something to break this bottleneck, and hiring of girls as human computers was never going to fill the gap. And so I was very much on the lookout for mechanical means of solving the problem.
And by a happy coincidence, a possible solution was on their doorstep. At the Moore School of Electrical Engineering, John Morkley, a physicist, had been exciting the interest of a talented 23-year-old engineer, J. Presper Eckert, in an ambitious plan to build an electronic computer. But the machine they designed would use no less than 18,000 valves. Experts were scornful. It was a well-known fact that valves were unreliable. They tended to burn out. One authoritative estimate was that a machine with 18,000 would break down every 5 seconds. Nevertheless, the Army agreed to fund the project, showing extraordinary confidence in the youthful Eckert.
This thing had more than 100 times as many tubes in it as anything else had, several hundred times as many tubes as anything else had. And we had decided very early in the game that the only way that this would be manageable would be if we made it in modular sections, which plugged in, which meant repair could be done by not pulling out a tube if something was wrong, but by pulling out a section that didn't work and plugging in a new spare. But in addition to that, we went to great efforts to design the circuits with a set of mathematical rules which ensured that all the parts could be out of tolerance by the maximum expected amounts and still work. We called this worst, worst design, meaning if everything was in the worst, worst way, it would still work. It's the kind of thing these days, on a much bigger scale,